Mike, what are you eating?
I'm eating a little biscottini.
Okay.
Biscottino? Biscottini? That's one or single?
All right, Mike, don't worry. Stick with the Greek, please. Are we live?
Oh, we're live.
One, two, three, go.
What is up, everybody? And welcome back to the Serie A Audio Experience with IFTV. We've got a very special guest with us, a long time in the making. Massimo Basile, journalist from Corriere dello Sport. Massimo, how you doing?
Oh, great. Great night. Thank you.
I love the Viola Calcio shirt, by the way.
Where did you get that shirt,
Massimo? This is the color.
No, I said, but where did you get it from?
Flores.
Oh, Flores. Is
that right? It brings out your eyes a lot.
Yeah, I like that. Looks great.
Anto, can you guess what team he supports with the color of the shirt?
With the Viola, gotta be Fiorentina, I hope, you know?
Is it right?
Hey, but you know what? You can look good on AC.
Love that.
But listen, Massimo, you can look good on an AC Milan shirt.
No. Massimo is Fiorentina, and that's
definitely,
it, right?
Yeah, definitely not AC Milan.
It's not like this guy here across from the table here, right?
We call Michael the flipper. Antonio calls him the flipper because Michael likes to support different teams, many different teams.
Only the teams.
No, I'm a Serie A fan, so I support all
the
teams.
Are you a winning man?
Yeah. Am I who?
A win.
No, I mean,
winning.
Nah, sometimes it depends. If you have a good mercato, maybe I'll hop on, you know?
Now, ask him today what team he supports.
Yeah.
Mike, tell him.
Today?
Yeah.
I don't know. Today, I don't think I chose.
Because there's no game. That's
why. Well, today, Olympiacos is playing for Champions League,
ooh,
so I'm supporting them.
So he goes back. He goes back to.
Yeah, I go back and forth.
Back to the mainland.
I did that in soccer.
When what?
Yeah.
In Serie A,
in soccer, Serie A.
In Serie A, no one in particular. I like all the teams.
Inter,
like
he knows
Inter,
everyone.
I like Juve, I like Roma, I like Milan, I like Parma, Fiorentina, Spezia, Crotone, Frosinone.
There's nothing they can do wrong.
Ascoli.
Mike,
Antonio, according to you, who does Michael support?
Inter.
I think you're wrong.
because this is the season.
Oh, it's been the season for a long time.
You think they're the favorite? Inter?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, we're gonna get into that, and it's funny if you check on our Instagram stories. Peter just got we set up our little AstroTurf in the back, a little field, and Peter got it directly in, and we all said, all right, that means that Inter is gonna win the Scudetto. Before we get into it, I want everybody to send in some questions that you have for Massimo and for everybody at the table. Some Fiorentina specific. If you have questions about Comiso, the stadium, anything, journalism, all these kind of good stuff. Massimo and everybody else is here to answer them. You know what's really funny? Do you know how this is happening? How Massimo's here right now?
Why?
How we met?
How did you meet? We met on a tournament.
Okay. Yeah, but do you know how he's with? How he was at that tournament?
Because of what? I don't know.
So, I had a wedding in Rome, a family wedding in Rome, and pull up to the hotel. First thing I see, the hotel, and I see Corriere dello Sport. Mm. So I said, "Oh wow, this is interesting." I said, maybe I'll go in. Maybe I'll meet somebody. So I said, before I go in, I said, let me search on Instagram or Twitter. I said, let me see if anybody follows us. So I type in Corriere dello Sport. And if you look on Twitter, the first people that follow you will pop up. Mm-hmm. And I see Massimo Basile, Corriere dello Sport. So I follow him and I send him a message. I said, hi, Massimo. I know this is very random. I saw you're following our page. You know, I'm right next door. You know, I'm at a wedding. You know, maybe I could come by and we could talk. I went by, we talked, we met, and we had an incredible time. We remained friends, and then you ended up moving to New York.
Yeah.
How was the food, by the way? Yeah. It was good?
It was incredible.
Yeah, it's incredible. And we did it in 2 hours' time.
Wow.
And we had it. It's so funny. We stayed so long together, and we started talking about the history of Serie A. We talked about Italians, Italian-Americans, and all this kind of incredible stuff. The office is amazing.
Do you remember the calcino?
I do. I know. You took a picture when we were playing foosball.
We got to get one in the back.
Yeah.
That's the next thing that comes up. But so it's hilarious how this all happened through social media. And you actually knew a lot about what we were doing and all this kind of good stuff. So it made it a lot of fun. Yeah. And now he's in New York. And we said we have to do a podcast one day. Massimo, before we go too far, everybody, I see it already in the comments saying Chiesa. Everybody saying Federico Chiesa.
Chiesa wants to go to you. But, Rocco... asked for big money, so I think that it's very difficult. But I think that in next 2 weeks we can see something new about the future of the player to Juve.
Really,
Massimo? I think Juventus has got somebody on that position already.
They have no money at the moment, but
who's they?
Juventus? But they want a player like
Chiesa.
Yeah.
But you know what? I think for him, for I was just telling the other day on the podcast, I was saying that Chiesa so far, he hasn't shown what he's capable to do. It's just he's got all of those potential, but he hasn't unleashed them on the field so far because, you know, he's been very spotty. You know, once in a while, sometimes he's on, sometimes he's off, sometimes he's upset. It's just, it's like his mood swing. It's too much, goes up and down. So, but what would you value Chiesa right now? You personally, if you were to buy him, I said, what would you spend for him?
40 million.
40?
40 million. 40.
You see, that's what I've been saying. You guys, 60, 70, 80. No,
well, it's not really us that's saying.
It's what Fiorentina wants.
Yeah. That's the market, you know. But I think that Chiesa, don't go wrong. Chiesa represents a kind of different on the ground because he has his speed, he has mentality. But a lack of scoring.
Mm-hmm.
That's the problem for him. Mm-hmm. But I think that with in a big club, he could improve and become a very top player.
So first of all, you're saying in the next 2 weeks, you think something can happen with Federico Chiesa in leaving Fiorentina?
Probably.
Even in this market where everybody's saying, oh, it's hard to buy players or spend a lot of money on players, you still think that Chiesa could leave Fiorentina?
Maybe Milan, they said that they might be taking him.
Yeah, Milan is very keen on him. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I think that everything can happen in the next weeks because Chiesa wants to go away.
You think Chiesa still wants to leave Juventus? Still wants to leave Fiorentina? Even...
He looked very happy on the last game.
Know, this is the season that is going to the Europei, so it's important for him playing in the starting 11.
But Massimo, here's my point. Okay, just me. I could be wrong. Okay, let me just ask you something.
Probably wrong.
First of all, for Fiorentina to give away Chiesa, they might have already have somebody else in mind that might be willing to move to Florence.
Yeah.
Number one. Number two, let's say he goes to Juventus. What happens if he gets to spend a lot of time on the bench with Pirlo? Or he goes to AC Milan and he winds up sitting on AC Milan's bench because AC Milan's got Rebic, he's got Ibrahimovic, he's got Salismaker, he's got a lot of options up there. So for Chiesa to be making a move and to project himself playing for Mancini on the Italian national team, you better have you better say, hey, listen, I'm moving from A to B, but if I'm coming to B, I want to be on the field. I don't want to be sitting on the bench. Because if you're going to showcase what you're capable to do, just you have to do it on the grass. You're not going to do it sitting on a bench.
Yeah. I totally agree. But if I could have the opportunity to talk to Chiesa, I would say this.
Mm.
Because clearly, he should have the opportunity to be a player, a top player. In Fiorentina, he can do that.
But on the flip
in
coin,
Juventus, it's difficult. But you know,
it's possible.
But it's very. Okay.
But Massimo, let me ask you something. Then Pete, it's a good point. But I don't want to lose my thought. But you are. Listen to me. No,
Pete.
No,
Pete. Reader, we don't care if you lose your thought. As long as Antonio doesn't lose
Listen, listen, Massimo. This is Chiesa, right?
Yeah?
You are plugged in Florence over here, okay? You have Ribery, you have Andrea Bat, you have nothing but the best to meet. Fiorentina's got one of the best midfield right now in Serie A. So you got all of those spectacular players that you didn't have last year that are going to be actually servicing you for you to showcase what you're capable to do. I think you have a better chance to be called in the national team and to be doing extremely well this year and to increase the value of your cartellino.
I think wherever he goes, he's still going to be on the national team. There's no if, buts, or when about that. He's one of the better wingers that Italy has right now. The only difference is with Fiorentina, it's all about ambition, I think, more than anything else. Because at that age, he knows that if Juventus and Milan are calling him, he's ready to go because he wants the ambition to win, you know, especially Juventus, to maybe win a Scudetto, to maybe go deep in Champions League. Milan, play for Champions League, you know? So those are all things that a player has to consider.
How about you
the
guys?
Same
do you want,
time,
him, do you want
at
him
the same,
to?
No.
Oh,
at
wow.
the same time.
In Milan, he could have, could have better chances.
Yeah, he has better chances in Milan, 100%. And also the way Fiorentina plays, Chiesa's farther away from goal. He's not going to score more than 10 goals this year in the position that he's playing right now.
But it's a right winger.
No.
So you want to put him on the center, like a forward?
No, but he's not an attacking winger, what I'm trying to say. He's playing more like up and down to cover the whole wing. Mm. So he's farther away from goal. When he, if he goes to Milan, I think he would have a better chance of scoring more goals. Juventus, we're still trying to figure out what formation Pirlo is going to play. You know, he's been experimenting, obviously, because of the players that he has this, you know, at his disposal. But, you know, I think Chiesa had it in his mind already from last year that he was going. Now it's just a matter of if the money is right.
Mm-hmm.
For Rocco now, on Fiorentina's perspective, this is not a selling market. This is not one you want to sell.
Yeah.
So if Rocco keeps on saying that he doesn't need the money, I don't see him leaving for less than 50. Woo.
Yeah.
So it's going, it's the number has gone down from 70 to 60 to 50. But if all Juventus offers is 40 million, I'll put my neck on the line, as you say, and say that he doesn't go anywhere.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And I think that we have a donation from Michele Frisoli, who is saying he's asking if Chiesa is ready to make that jump. In your opinion, is he ready to make the jump from Fiorentina to a Juventus, Milan, or Inter? Because actually, I wouldn't even put Inter in the case this summer. I think it's probably between Milan and Juventus, if that's fair to say. Do you think that he's got what it takes to make that jump?
I think yes. But he lacks of scoring skills.
Yeah.
But I imagine that in a top club, it could grow bigger and better. And so I think that he would have a very special opportunity to grow better.
Marco, well, that's also like where his position is, because, you know, there's been some debate. You know, they play a 3-5-2. He started as a right wing back now. You know, he's played as a center, second striker. It's a little confusing. Where do you see Chiesa playing his best?
His natural position.
I still like a right wing.
Mm-hmm.
On the right side.
Because of his speed. So you can take the one-on-one.
Because he's able to point the opponents. You know,
but Massimo, if you are a Juventus manager and you have the plug Chiesa, would you pull out over there? Say, I'm going
to
plug Chiesa into the formation.
Would you
sacrifice? Kulusevski is not going to be moved there.
I think he fits Milan a lot better than he does because, Juventus.
Yeah. Well, listen, at this point, I'll call what's his name? I will call Pioli and say, listen, why don't you swap Salas Makers with Joe and take Chiesa? Salas Makers is a very young talent.
A straight swap? Anthony, you're
not going to swap. I mean, we give him a few $1,000s in addition. Joe, I was just kidding.
Well, Spanino, right? So
Paqueta could be an option.
Paqueta, I'll put Paqueta, $25, $30 million on the plate. It's not going to happen.
He was being nice about it, too.
Hey, Massimo, I'm giving you Salas Makers, which is an excellent winger, and I'm giving you Paqueta. That's a lot of money.
You have a good
Then keep him if he's that good.
Exactly.
He's not a good seller, rather.
I don't think they'll...
I think that's not...
Massimo, no thank you, right? No thank you.
Ciao. The offer is still on the table, okay?
I think it's also good to hear your perspective, too, on the price tag, because that's like one of the biggest things I think we've always discussed. We've obviously heard the 80 million, the 70 million is the range that they want. I'm more with you. I think he's between the 40, 45 million for a guy like Chiesa. And I think that, you know, he's still young. Is he 22, 21, 22 years old? He needs to improve in his scoring ability. I agree with you there.
Question, is that 40 million because of today's market?
Yeah.
Oh, so it is.
No, because now it's difficult to sell someone. Because the price is going down during this period.
So with the potential of Fiorentina selling Chiesa, do they have a substitute? Has there been talks about substituting Chiesa?
Actually, I don't know that, but I think they're talking about Candreva, for example. But it's not, just a moment, it's not the same level.
Please.
Because he's a different kind of player, you know. But to find the solution right now, in a short time, and so I think that a player like him could be a good option.
Yeah, you can put Borja on the right hand side and just make him work.
No, you can. No, you cannot. Borja Valero cannot play there.
Borja Valero will not play there.
He would not play there.
There's also that brought up a question in my head for you. Is we've heard a lot about Fiorentina and the number nine. You know, they want somebody else as a striker. Is there anyone in your head that you think that you would love to see leading Fiorentina's line?
I don't know.
Batistuta.
Batistuta it was. But
in my opinion, my heart is Giancarlo Antonioni. Yeah.
But it was not a 9, it was a 10. Giancarlo Antonioni era un regista.
Yeah, but
era un regista.
I'm sure you can put him there, plug him.
Batistuta, yeah.
Yeah, that's, yeah. That's a 9.
But somebody now, realistic. Is there anyone in your head that you see in the market that's possible? Milik. That's also realistic?
Milik. Milik. Milik can work.
Milik. Piontek.
Piontek.
That's what you're talking about a lot.
Yeah.
Piontek.
I
that's
know
a
that
good idea.
Fiorentina love Piontek. Iachini asking for him.
Mm.
Yeah, in January, during January markers.
Wow.
Iachini asking for him.
Would you like it? Are you a little scared? But based off what happened with Milan, obviously Piontek is a strange one, because at Genoa he did amazing, started at Milan, did amazing, and then dipped. You think it's too much of a risk, or do you like the player for Fiorentina? You think that he still has a lot to give?
Actually, I don't know. I think that
it's a different team, small market, smaller market. So I think he might do well over there, Massimo.
Yeah,
what do you think?
It's very difficult.
Mm-hmm.
And the more you go forward with the spirit of market, and the more difficult it is to find the perfect player to substitute a player like him.
It's true. It's true.
It's incredible.
No, no. This is going back, and this is probably a far-fetched question, but with Iachini, Iachini seems to have been, you know, put there, confirmed. But there's a lot of question marks about Iachini and how long he can stay, because he, you know, his track record isn't one that you can say that you can, as a Fiorentina fan, be so thrilled about, right? Yeah. So now, does Fiorentina make these decisions based off what Iachini wants, or based off what the overall, let's say, management, what they see as the overall Fiorentina project?
I think my friend Joe Barone knows. I'm going to answer for you, Massimo. Joe Barone knows a lot more than Iachini in terms of technical ability in some of the whichever player he wants to plug into the team. And I'm sure he's the one confiding with the Rocco, but said, hey, this would be doing A, B, C, and D.
Yeah,
so Iachini might just have a little wish list, but at the end of the day, it's Joe that is feeding he's feeding Comiso with those right information.
I'll piggyback on his.
They have chosen another coach, you know.
Right?
Yeah. Juric.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Ah, that's a good one.
They had good talks with him.
That's a good one.
But at a certain point, Rocco Comiso said, stop it, because I'm not convincing him. And I want, I can't fire a coach like Iachini that is doing so good.
Right.
That was a
but
big.
But they had a deal
with
Juric.
Mm. They had a deal with Juric.
Yeah, really.
Wow, he plays good football. You know, I like
because,
Juric.
Yeah, they love Juric. A man like him, because they wanted a kind of scorer that was able to grow the young players.
Mm-hmm. I can see
Juric. I think that he
and he plays a good soccer too. Good soccer, great soccer.
Yeah, the question mark about him is that the last season was the first very good season for Juric.
Mm-hmm.
So Rocco Comiso said, really? He's really good?
Is that a good? It hasn't been proven so far in two, three consecutive seasons.
Really,
let's see.
Really.
You know what? Just
it's different if you think of Allegri or Ancelotti.
But will it be cheaper? How much will Juric? Juric transfer to Florence?
You know what
kind of
came into my head though when you said that? And I completely forgot that this was a rumor. There was those talks about De Rossi.
Oh,
do you remember?
Yeah, remember?
Do you remember that De Rossi was apparently going to become the next Fiorentina coach?
Listen to me. That was a fake news.
Fake news.
Yeah.
Fake news.
Yeah, everything started when De Rossi talked to Daniele Prade. He said, can you help me to find a way to get the license as a pro coach? And Prade answered back, if you become a coach, you could be an option in the future. So that's it.
Not the immediate future.
No, absolutely.
In
the future, but I think that Daniele De Rossi could become
absolutely.
So kind of a some sort of misunderstanding with De Rossi is becoming.
No,
not so much misunderstanding. The journalist taking what they more
just
they want.
But if you remember, I sent you a text and say just it's a fake news.
don't follow it.
I will search. I will search right now. I remember I texted you right away, and you told me. You said there's no way that I. All right, I texted you. Okay, I'm gonna read the exact message.
This is privacy.
Nobody's gonna know. Just give me a New York Times.
He said July 3rd, 2020. I texted you. De Rossi? Question mark? Question mark? Question mark? Question mark? You wrote back one word: impossible. Just so you know where he stood right away. It was right when it came out.
Impossibile.
So, I think we all kind of felt that way. But now, you know what's funny? We thought that was crazy. And I remember we sent a group message. We said, oh, De Rossi, Fiorentina, it's never going to happen. Now, if we look at Pirlo becoming the Juventus coach, it's like almost as crazy.
Yeah, yeah, you're right.
Which is funny. It's funny to see. You were very much in favor if De Rossi would have gone, though, just right?
Listen, I believe that some of those great players that they play the game at the highest level, for some reasons, not all of them, but a lot of them, they want to become successful coaches. Stop with this Maradona BS.
No. I had a question for Massimo. What did you think when Juventus actually announced Pirlo as their manager? Did you think it was crazy? What was
wonderful
your first thought?
Wonderful idea.
For you, Massimo.
He's going to tell you.
I was very surprised. You know, as everybody, but I think that Pirlo was a very good player. He's like everybody says that he was a kind of coach, no? Mm-hmm. A coach player. But I think it's, I don't know, actually, because I think that it's a risk. But still very early to say something about it. But mm-hmm. the first game was very good.
Mm-hmm.
He managed the game in a very professional way.
We got a donation from Preciado, and he asked a question that something that you and I talked about when we first met. His question is, what's it going to take for Serie A to be globally respected as the best league in the world? Is it Champions League? Is it more stars coming? What are your thoughts on Serie A and how Serie A needs to get back to the top?
I think that they need to have more foreign ownerships.
More foreign ownership.
Mm-hmm. Because they have to grow bigger in an international way. Because it's important. Because from the United States, people with a new mentality can improve the marketing of the Serie A, the TV system.
Mm-hmm.
I think that is important.
Massimo, this is very much why we also agree.
Yes. I actually agree with him, but I want to add something else. I think it's the experience that is missing. The experience of somebody going to the stadium and relate to the game and just be part of the game. That's why the new stadiums, the smaller stadium like English Premier League, you actually talking to the player over there. You actually can bring them in or can just push them around a little bit. You are almost into the game.
You are into the game
over there. Look at this. Except for San Siro, which is designed, or Marassi, and Torino.
Olimpico too.
The vast majority of the stadiums, there might be beautiful structure from outside, architecturally speaking, but then the experience is missing. You go over there, and sometimes you have to take the binocular to be able to find out what's going on. So I think that's a big part. I mean, the marketing is one of the big things. The foreign ownership, but the experience itself. You know, you bring a kid to the game. A kid, if it's not really closer to the action, it's going to start to play video games over there. So you have to just bring them into the game, and that's what's missing, I think.
Absolutely. But you think that the difference of mentality is that the ownership from America, they put the fans on the top of the system.
Yes.
The Italian ownership, they put
the player. Yeah, you're right.
On the basement. Yeah. In the basement.
Maybe on the cellar.
I understand. Under the basement. And so that's the difference.
It's great point.
A different world.
Mm-hmm. Well, now obviously we have Kraus, who just went for Padma, the new owner of Padma from Iowa. He made it very clear he's from Iowa. The sports
Iowa.
Is that where the big potatoes that come over there?
No, that's Idaho.
Idaho. Oh, I almost said yes.
Same thing.
Iowa is the land of friendship, of friend people. Mm-hmm. Some told me.
Oh, yeah? You know more about America than we do that.
He seems he seems friendly, so.
It's a farm. Very farming.
Farms?
Yeah, supposedly in Des Moines, there were a lot of Italian farmers.
They
really?
What did they find? Potatoes?
Pulpit?
Corn? What do they farm? What do I know?
Do we know anything about him? Anyone know anything about Kraus?
I know that he's very passionate about soccer.
Yeah. No, yeah.
the system of restaurant linked to the gas stations.
Convenience store.
And the high, but he has a real estate, winery, restaurants.
Good.
He's a big businessman. Also, just to go off Massimo, he actually owns the rights to a pro USL soccer team in Iowa, he's been a big push. Experience. Yeah, he's got a big push for soccer. He's a big soccer fan. He's very proud of his Italian heritage. I saw in like one of his articles, interviews rather, where he said, you know, his great grandparents are from Sicily, from his mother's side. Like he said, he owns a vineyard. Yeah. He was married in Italy. His son was married in Italy. Mm. He loves Italy. So this is what you need as a president, because anyone that thinks they're gonna go to Italy or go anywhere in soccer as a president and make a lot of money, you got yourself fooled. Yeah. Because there's a lot of money that's gonna be coming out of your pocket. It's not like American sports. But he's passionate longer about term. It.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a longer exactly. term project.
It's not a quick. Oh,
come on, guys! It's a very historical moment for Italian soccer, because if you think of the American people, no. We have an Italian-American like Rocco Commisso, a Californian Texan like Fred King.
Mm-hmm.
Now we have.
We got Elliot. We got Iowa. Elliot. We got Elliot.
Elliot. Elliot. Elliot. Big man.
From New York. Yeah. Is he from New York? Yeah. This guy here.
He lives here.
I know. I want to meet him.
Yeah.
Not because I like the guy. I want him to spend more money.
Yeah.
I'm gonna see. I'm gonna see if I can squeeze him.
Yeah.
What would you say to him? What would be the?
I
would
say, hey, listen, paisa, this is not a burger. It's in Milan. It's not something that you just cook from one side, you flip it, and you sell it. This is a team.
Did
this
you
is
meet
a,
him?
No. Yeah. I like to meet
you
him.
Should.
I think I should meet him because I want to talk some
Why don't
sense
you go
to him.
Fix one of his buildings. Over
yeah.
There.
Yeah. But anyway, so
with Milan kit.
Yeah.
You go there. So
yeah, go there with the Milan
kit.
Yeah. If they see him, they're gonna sell the club right away. They're like, "These are our fans."
Listen,
they go right away.
If I get the money,
talks like a manager.
Listen,
man.
If so I get the money, actually, you know what? When we're talking about Rocco Commisso over here, it's on the equation. Rocco Commisso was supposed to be the one buying AC Milan.
Yeah,
and that will be the best thing that will ever happen to me, at least. To know that an Italian American, a Southerner like me, buying an AC Milan, even though he grew up as a Juventus fan, but that takes very little away from the equation that Rocco. Yes. Rocco is a great manager.
Hey, you know, he offered $500
million. Yeah, I know, and I know. A lot more money than what Elliot spent to get AC Milan.
Yeah, Rocco Commisso offered.
Close to $500
million. $500 million. Yeah, and they said no.
Mm-hmm.
And he keeps thinking, why? They gave me that answer.
He didn't raise his offer anymore?
Yeah, no.
That's why?
I don't know.
Because it was Lee Massimo, wasn't that the Chinese kid over there?
But that was a strange story, you know, because you know, Mr. Lee is a very mysterious man.
But with Rocco, he offered for Milan $500 million, but couldn't raise the offer anymore.
No, because Mr. Lee decided to offer more, but in the second time we discovered that he had no money.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I'm saying
we didn't understand how it bought Milan.
There's something fishy.
I understand.
Close the deal.
I don't care about.
And Rocco Commisso keeps asking for this.
Ah.
He keeps telling why they didn't buy Milan to me.
They didn't sell Milan to me. Yeah.
Okay.
Why didn't?
Because Rocco was offering more money, Marco. Rocco was offering more money. That while Elliot wound up getting the team for a lot less because he's the one that pony up the money to.
And then the opportunity of Fiorentina came about.
Yeah.
For Rocco.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. It's interesting. It's interesting. Yeah. And I know.
The story changes.
Fair enough.
Destiny.
I know, Peter, you had a question about the stadium, right?
Yeah.
It was something that you were wondering.
Well, there was a big amendment in Italy that passed for the... I don't know exactly how you would say it, but about the reconstruction of the stadium or...
restructuring of the stadium?
Not necessarily restructuring, like as far as like landmarks are concerned.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That stadiums are no longer considered landmarks.
Mm-hmm.
So Massimo, I don't know if you can explain a little bit more about this amendment and what it could potentially mean for not only Fiorentina,
getting a new stadium.
San Siro.
For San Siro, Rome,
yeah. It's important because now the situation is changing. Mm-hmm. Now you have much more opportunities to rebuild the stadium in an historical place. That's very important. And I think that what is going to happen in Florence with Rocco Commisso and Fiorentina could change the situation in Italian soccer, because so we could have many clubs to rebuild and to build at all the new stadium. And soccer, Italian Serie A, needs that.
Anything with Fiorentina Stadium? Because I know we've heard a lot about what's going to happen. A lot of the people are asking with the stadium. Anything on that?
Yeah, the situation is that Rocco Commisso wants to build a stadium in Campo di Marte in Florence. This is the historical part.
Far is that from the current stadium?
No, it's
the same?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It's there. But there is a second option. Campi Bisenzi is a part, is outside. Outside. But I think that now he prefers to build stadium in Florence. It would be great, no? For Florence, for tourism, because you have a great
you are in a shooting distance
in the city, and so it's iconic.
So what's holding it back then?
I think that
it's bureaucracy in Italy, Marco. Yeah. Believe me, it's not easy. First of all, we have the equivalent in the United States. We have the zoning regulation and all the stuff. First of all, you have to de-zone the area because you are saying it's no longer a landmark. In Italy, the equivalent landmark is la sovrintendenza ai beni naturali. It's a landmark.
Oh, okay.
It's a translation for landmark. Oh, yeah, okay. So over there is a piano regolatore. Piano regolatore is basically technically he identifies all of the zones, like industrial zone. It's pretty much the same way that we have the zoning regulation over here in the United States. Then a new stadium in place of the existing one will mean not to spend a lot of money in what we call in Italy opere di urbanizzazione primaria e secondaria, which are roads, lights, infrastructure, parking, and all that kind of stuff. So once you take all of those money out of the equation, so the stadium can become a reality within a year. Because if you get a good somebody that is bidding on the project, hopefully an Italian company.
From an American situation.
The timing to get this thing here, true, Marco, it's like times 10. Over here, if you put a project through the building department, within a month or 3 weeks, you've been given a bunch of approval or disapproval.
I wanted to hear from
for a stadium.
Right. For a stadium too. A stadium too. If the area has been allowed to be built for that kind of infrastructure, all you have to do is just get the approval and get landmark to get you through. In Italy, it's a nightmare. You're going to go through the comune, you're going to go through to so many different bodies.
The situation is going to change with this rule.
How so? With this rule, you think that stadiums will be able to get
if
built
it's
now?
No longer about landmark, then there's landmark. No need to.
The new stadium in a new place, the situation is the same as the past. But with the landmark, the situation is very changing.
So you have
the opportunity to rebuild totally.
Mm-hmm. Not just renovate.
A new stadium, yeah. For example, just to give an example, in Florence, you can build a new stadium in the place
of those
where the Artemio Franchi, the historical Artemio Franchi stays.
You can.
Yeah.
You can.
No, you can. Or really, you can in the Italian form. So you can.
You're going to look at the details, of details.
You can talk with politics, with politicians, just to have the. Okay.
But as far as ownership, Massimo, as far as ownership, are they allowing foreign enterprise to just go over there and say, okay, listen, I'm gonna be footing the bills, I'm gonna be spending all of those money for the streets, lights, and create a lot of business in the surrounding and make sure it's a lot of people, gaining employment from the project.
Yeah,
that would be the payoff for having somebody a non-Italian enterprise to jump into this kind of project, or will be just the Italian government say, no, we need A, B, C, and D, and you cannot own the stadium? So Commisso, if he's going to build a stadium, wants to be the owner of the stadium. Am I right or wrong?
Not owned by the city.
Yeah. This is the right
all question marks.
Yeah.
That yeah. Have to
you see?
A good point.
You
see?
Well, but you could even have a 99-year lease where it works, you know, to a certain extent, just as good, because you can still make money off of any sponsorship,
right,
naming rights and whatnot with a 99-year lease. For example, there's a baseball stadium in Coney Island, MCU Park, is parkland. So it's owned by the city of New York. The only difference is it's a 99-year lease to whatever company that owns it.
The one thing I loved about the Artemio Franchi when we went is we walked from where we were to it, and it was walking distance for us. Especially you're in New York, we walk everywhere. It was like one of the greatest walks, and we walked with a lot of the fans going there that are singing. It was an incredible atmosphere, and I'm not to get rid of it, but there was something so special about Florence. Is, in my opinion, one of the most beautiful cities in the world.
Yes.
It's incredible. But then walking to the stadium and feeling that atmosphere as you walk with the fans all by your side and going towards the Franchi, I loved it. Yeah. So I hope that I don't want it to be on the outskirts, because I think, you know, if you're a fan watching and you say, you know, one day you want to go to a Fiorentina game, in my opinion, it's part of the experience, you know, going there, eating outside.
Absolutely. Crossing the bridge too. I love crossing that bridge to go there.
Ponte Vecchio. No. I don't think you've
Ponte Vecchio. Not that bridge.
You've been to the Franchi.
What's
the best game that you've watched live of Fiorentina?
we'll give you a minute.
I remember
Fiorentina Juventus when Chiesa when what's his
Giuseppe
name
Rossi.
Giuseppe Rossi scored three goals.
Yeah, no,
he wasn't there.
I remember two games in a row that I saw Fiorentina Inter 4-3 and Fiorentina Juve 2-1
per la Fiorentina
the Sunday next.
Beautiful.
In 2 weeks
you watch both of them in a row. What was Florence?
Was ultra.
What
with was Baggio, Roberto Baggio.
Mamma mia.
Hold on.
Roberto Baggio, Stefano Borgonovo. This was very incredible. In 1989.
So wait, explain to us, as a Fiorentina fan, being in Florence, when Baggio, when you're beating Inter and Juventus, what was the city like?
Too much. Baggio was too much.
I fed up with his emotions. I was very tired. I like the player, but... At the end of the game.
Like he played the game.
Yeah, I was without the energy. that was incredible. I needed to take a shower.
Just before you got to the stadium. The emotion.
I can imagine if you check, you know what would be hilarious? If they had some sort of stat on the amount of babies born 9 months after that week after the two wins.
Roberto.
One after the other.
Roberto Baggio.
We always have, how old were you when you watched Baggio over there? How old were you?
30.
20.
20?
No.
24, 25.
No. 25. My biography now. No, really, but it is agree.
So, okay.
24.
In your opinion, we've had this debate a lot about Baggio. How incredible was Baggio? He played for your team. How amazing. Describe to us how
that
Baggio
people
was.
Don't know, like us, we didn't watch him live.
It's incredible because he was the kind of player with a simple body, no? As a normal body. But he had a technique so unique, and it was poetry. I remember that I went to see the first game he played in the under 20 team. After because
the
U20. He had a very
trouble.
And so he started to play with the young players. And I remember that I went there and we were 10,000 people to see the match. Just to
That's
see
crazy.
Roberto Baggio, that for us, he represented the future of the soccer or the Fiorentina.
Wow. If you could, I have a couple questions about it. If you can name a player, relate a player for the people now, there's a lot of younger fans that watch us, you know, 17, 18 years old, that don't remember. If you could relate Baggio to one player that plays now, is there anyone in your mind, either whether status-wise, like how good they are, or just their playing style, Is there anyone that you see now that reminds you of Baggio a little bit?
Do you mean another player like him?
Like another player like him
that plays now
in terms of how good they are?
Yeah,
Dybala. Who?
Yeah,
Dybala is similar to
him. Yeah, Anton. I want to know Massimo.
No, but I want to know Massimo. No, he's gonna get his own. He's gonna get his own. Don't take mine. He's gonna take his own.
He's getting jealous.
Yeah, I know.
I love him. Like Dybala.
Dybala could be one.
Don't say Lautaro, please.
Lautaro is different.
In terms of the level, like somebody that's dominating now, is there anyone like not at the level of Messi?
No.
But where?
No, because I think that it's very difficult to compare.
Compare
because it's different because they play in the different teams. Messi in Barcelona, Baggio in Fiorentina and Juventus. But I don't know, probably Totti, Mancini.
Mancini, definitely.
Yeah. Ronaldinho. Maybe.
I don't want to spoil this part. I don't want to make you upset right now, but I have to ask because it's in my head. As a Fiorentina fan, it was obviously a big moment when he went to Juventus.
Yeah.
What was the feeling by you, the Fiorentina fans, and in the city when he went to Juventus?
Now, that was the match for us. I remember that. You mean when he left
Fiorentina and when you went to Juventus?
That was a shock, you know. Maybe you don't know, but there was a struggle on the street, like Black Lives Matter, a kind of, really.
Protest.
With 1,000 people, 1,000 fans on the street, and gas, and struggle, and fighting just to protest.
Wow. Because Baggio was leaving. Yeah. Wow.
That's crazy.
Because that was a double shock. Because of leaving, and because he was leaving to Juventus. So that's very incredible.
The rivals.
Was it a Baggio decision or was it a Fiorentina decision?
Was a Juventus decision.
Yeah.
Wait, hey, let me just give you a little background, Marco. You might not know because you're too young. Let me give you a little background.
No, but
Florence had, before Baggio, he had Antonioni, preceding him, pretty much on the same role, and before him was De Sisti. Those are all great icons on Florence. Mm-hmm. Okay, De Sisti was one of the big icons of the Italian national team too, and then Antonioni. We know.
He
won the World Cup with 1982 with Berzot and Rossi, and we know the whole story. But Baggio took the cetro. What do you call it? The cetro.
Staff. The armband, like the to continue.
Guarda fa la staffetta come ti danno la
torch.
Okay, took the torch. Bravo, he took the torch and said, "Hey, this was the symbol. Was the symbol of Florence, technically." And then when Agnelli snatched Baggio away from Florence.
Went out.
Yeah.
You know what did they say in Florence about the story of Baggio leaving to
explain, please?
you get it ready for this one.
Baggio didn't want to go there.
Mm-hmm.
But Juventus and Fiorentina made the deal. Okay? Before the Coppa UEFA, UEFA Cup final, no? The first match, Baggio told the club, I don't want to go to Juventus. Then Luca di Montezemolo, this is the story they told me. Luca di Montezemolo had a talk with
who's
Baggio.
That? Who is this?
Luca Montezemolo.
He was the president della Ferrari. He was Luca Cordero di Montezemolo, one of the biggest guys from Agnelli.
And they say that he said, Baggio, if you don't come to Juventus, you don't go to the World Cup with the Italia.
Oh man!
This is the story.
This is the story. I don't know if it's true or not. But what the story says that Roberto Baggio, the day next in the match, he played the worst game in his life.
Right.
He was very shocked.
Wow, that's crazy.
You know what, Marco, it's a very important point I'm going to make. Those two guys that I've just named before, Antonioni and De Sisti, they played their whole career in Florence. And Baggio was another one that was expecting to, like Maldini, like Rivera, like Mazzola, few others in Italy to be basically the torch.
Bandiera, la bandiera.
La bandiera, yeah, la bandiera, yeah, di Firenze. So once you've been forced against your own will to just wear another jersey, yeah, then it's a big shock, not only for the player itself, but for the entire city, yeah, and la tifoseria. So just to give you a little bit more of a background.
Mm. We have a couple donations.
We didn't win anything like club, but we had so very important 10 players. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Antonioni, De Sisti, Ricosta.
Ricosta was good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have a question that's related to that. There's a few donations. Mohammed, I see yours. I don't want to change the topic with that. There's also a donation from Nick who said, "What's up, guys? I'm an AC Milan fan, but I enjoy listening to Peter because he has great knowledge of the game. Love you too, Antonio. Forza Milan." But I want to read Oscar's donation, who it's related to Fiorentina and his questions towards you. Oscar said, "Where do you see Fiorentina in the next 5 years? Can they become Europa League regulars, top four contenders, and can Comiso get Fiorentina to return them to their former glory?" So 5 years from now.
Yeah, I think that regularly in the European Cups.
Which European Cup?
Europa League.
Europa League. Then maybe in five years, maybe in Champions League. But I hope to win a National Cup.
Scudetto.
No, Coppa Italia.
National Coppa Italia. Cup.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Okay, that's fair enough. You've obviously...
Scudetto, I think it's impossible at this moment.
He's being realistic.
I gotcha. Fair enough.
It would be fantastic for us. Because,
you would burn the city down.
Like fans, yeah. We want to be happy.
Celebrate.
We want to fight for something.
Yeah.
Massimo, don't get your hope too high because those guys, they already took everything. So whatever is any little thing that is left for us, we're going to just fight it.
Hey, that's mine.
Inter is for school.
Oh, for everything. They got everything already.
Especially in the summer. Mm.
There's a lot of questions about your thoughts on Comiso, on how you've seen Comiso. Obviously, you've spoken to Comiso, you've interviewed Comiso. What are your thoughts on him and how his first season has gone?
I had a regular meeting with him. He's very passionate. It's very, he has a great energy because, you know, he wants to leave something to Italy, to Florence, to France. And he looks like the old owners, old president of the 70s, now for soccer, that kind of soccer. Now, you know, Romain Conetani, Costantino Rossi, probably you remember.
Of course. Don't know. What does that mean?
No,
they play the game. They relate to the game a lot.
Because they were that kind of passionate presidents. Yeah, tifosi. It's different from the financial soccer that we live now. No, this is the fair play.
Not just about money.
Yeah, no, about money. No, this is about scores, about games, about fans, about supporters. And the thing I love the most of Rocco Commisso, that this thing keeps thinking of fans.
Mm-hmm.
He keeps telling, but what do they find? Think about Fiorentina. What do they the fans say about Fiorentina? How they lead the game? No, it's important because if you talk to the Italian president or the modern, the contemporary soccer, what you find is that they talk about money, about financial. It's so, how can I say? It's a cool feeling. Okay.
And that's awesome.
That's not soccer.
I think that's, obviously us who know Comiso a little bit more, we understand that. But some people outside don't really know exactly how he is. So it's great to have that kind of insight from you. And there's so many Fiorentina questions. I have a question for me personally, though.
Oh, you have a question for yourself?
No, for Massimo.
Okay.
I'm not going to ask myself a question.
Actually, we should do that, a segment. We should ask yourself a question and give yourself an
you
answer.
You ask yourself a question every day. I do it all the time. Massimo, in your journalist career, who's been the best interview you've had or the best story that you've come across?
Preferably funny too.
That comes into your mind?
Doesn't have to be the best. One of the best.
Alright, your favorite, your personal.
Right. Yeah.
Something that's special.
I could say the next one. But probably it's impossible now to think about it. Probably the first interview as a sports writer that I did to Batistuta.
Ooh.
Wow. Oh my God.
In Netherlands, yeah. Wow. Because it was, yeah, I went there for Reebok, okay? But at a certain point, the manager of Reebok told me, ah, you know that there is the Argentinian team at 100 miles from here.
Mm-hmm.
And so I thought, what? So Batistuta is there. Yeah. Do you want to meet him?
You did a backflip.
Really? Are you kidding me? Yeah, so he brought me there, and I met Batistuta, but we are talking about 1999. So it's a very different kind of relationship with players. It's different from now.
How is it different?
Yeah. And
how?
Yeah, because it was easier.
Easier
to meet players. Just to give an example. I went there in the place where the Argentinian was, okay, and I met him. There was no
agent. Did you have to talk to before?
People talking before too. No, it's different. So I remember that at a certain point, Batistuta came here in my small room, and so I said, "Oh, how are you doing?" I said, "Oh, Batistuta."
You fell in love, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that was the first interview as a sports writer to the top scorer of my team.
Was that still in Florence or was in Rome? I was about to leave Florence, though.
I was in Rome, but you know, the first part of my career, I worked as a crime reporter.
Got you.
Oh, wow.
A different.
Mm-hmm.
Different
that
job.
Was the second life, my second life as a sports writer. Mm-hmm. And the first interview was to Gabriel Batistuta.
That's amazing. And how he was nice. It was great.
No, really, really nice. And it was before an Inter Fiorentina match.
Oh. Mm.
Where you got your ass kicked again?
The difference is that now we have not a forward like him.
Yeah, Batistuta is amazing.
To make an interview, no, you know.
You have this contest permission because everything has to go through him.
Yeah,
and no, maybe Peter too.
Talking about Fiorentina and stuff.
I know.
I know a lot of the. Me personally, anybody think of some stuff that you have for Massimo before we end?
Mm-hmm.
And anybody else who has a question before we end about Fiorentina, about journalism, about Massimo, anything? This year for Fiorentina, obviously they finished. Last year we were saying about Fiorentina manager expectations. You know, I said 10th place would be great for them. Yeah. This year, what do you think the team needs or is missing, whether player-wise or coaching-wise or spirit-wise, to get to
the next level?
To get higher into the table. Like, in your eyes, what do you think is the most important thing for Fiorentina to change? Is it signing a couple players? Is it a coach? What is it?
I think that they need a larger management. Because I think that Daniele Prade and Joe Barone, they are a few people.
Overwhelmed with all the work.
Yeah, I think that they need to have more manager and management bigger.
Mm-hmm.
And a new coach, an international coach, I mean.
Like any examples?
For example...
Pochettino, baby.
Yeah, it would be great, but I feel
it's expensive,
that,
right?
Who are you thinking?
The former Valencia coach,
Lopez.
Spanish player.
Former.
Right now, when former? Just now or
10 years ago?
Yeah.
I'm looking.
I don't remember Valencia. Now, but for example, Inyo.
Marcelino.
Marcelino.
You scouted him? You think he's a good fit?
Yeah, I love him.
Wow.
I love him.
Really?
Because I think that to set Fiorentina on the top level, you need just not only a good coach, but a good philosopher.
A system. Okay.
Yeah, no, a philosopher, someone that have
idea.
A big picture.
Yeah,
a
someone
big
like Maurizio Sarri.
Yeah, he has a big picture of the world. Because it needs to talk not only to the team, but to people, to the city. Just, for example, kind of Mourinho or Paulo Sousa.
Mm-hmm.
It's not important only the techniques.
But the human quality of the player, the person.
Quality, for example, Bielsa.
I was about to say.
Some people are saying that you look like Bielsa, by the way. I keep seeing the comment come up.
I would love to have his mind, his brain. Very, very.
His football brain, right?
El Loco, yeah, right? That's his,
So you're done with your question?
Yeah, yeah, I'm done. There's, a couple more, but.
So I can have another question then for that. Yeah, okay. Massimo, on a scale of 1 to 10.
Oh, God. Oh, God.
Stop.
Okay. How much you hate Conte?
Well, we know.
Go.
On a scale of 1 to 10, how much more enthusiasm has brought Commisso has brought into Florence for the tifosi? Because he's the real tifoso, number one. And, I mean, he's the owner, but he's a real tifoso. Yeah. This guy played soccer. I'm not sure exactly where. I know he started in Columbia University and all that stuff. But he has the soccer in his bloodstream. And the guy, he breeds soccer. And for him to be investing that kind of money, not knowing exactly what to find in Italy, what how would be welcome and all the stuff. So how much passion did he bring in? And did he bring into Florence? And how much was he embraced by the tifoseria? And if on a scale of 1 to 10 again, what is the number that you will give to the to his job so far up to now? And what did the tifosi see in Commisso right now?
I think that he brought. A lot of
and Barone, enthusiasm. Of course, Joe, because Joe is part of it.
A lot of enthusiasm, absolutely, because Fiorentina came from a sad era.
Yeah.
Now with the whole ownership, they were a very cold one. So it's important. But I think that now Rocco Commisso and fans do need some wins to win.
Mm-hmm.
Because we have...
Be nice.
Yeah, we talked about the stadium, the market, and the new ownership, but now there is the summer. So it's important to see a team like Fiorentina is going up.
Mm-hmm.
It's fair enough. To improve, that's important. Because the score, win is win. And that's an important thing in Florence too. Even if there is a new ownership. But this is the secret of the soccer. You had to win.
Exactly.
Listen, last question. I got to get it out of my system before you go, Pete. How much is the press embracing Commisso? Because I know Commisso in the press in Italy, they've been fighting. And, you know, unjustly, Commisso was not treated well because a lot of stuff that was done to Fiorentina was done not the right way.
Yeah.
There were penalties taken away. There were penalties given against Fiorentina for that they were not penalties. So, you know, there were some exchanges that were not pretty because a lot of them, they came on primetime TV. But, you know, I appreciated the fact that it's very, very much up front. It's not going to just throw a curved ball and let you know from behind what's going on. Commisso is a direct person. If he's going to tell you something, it's going to tell you right on the face. And I don't think the TV and the media in Italy appreciate it that much because they have some of the big gun over there. They demand. For you, I said you're the last comer. You have to kiss my ring before you actually ask that question. What do you think? What's your take?
That's the point. Mm-hmm. Because at the beginning of his experience, he was treated like a Sopranos.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Like that is a stereotype, you know, the kind of stereotype.
Yeah, the Italian American, right?
American like Soprano, and that's not the man. Mm-hmm. It's very different. But I think that the difficulties he met with. Is that I think that when he speaks English, it's a different man. When he speaks Italian, it sounds different. And so it sounds like a Bronx guy. that can be difficult to understand.
Gotcha.
But that's good perspective.
The true Rocco Commisso. Is the one living in New York and speaks English and he speaks a very good English because he's a cultivated man.
Mm-hmm.
He's from Columbia University. Mm-hmm. But when he speaks in Italian, he has a different style. He speaks well.
Mm-hmm.
He speaks a very good Italian. But he has, he looks like a Bronx guy, okay?
I like that. Yeah, I like that. Don't mess with me, man.
So a lot of people start like
they get turned
this.
Off. They get turned off.
This is mafia.
There you go.
They wrongly
They don't like the traditional.
Americans are very different from what they imagine.
Okay. That's a very fair point. We just got a few more people that ask questions that I want to read off real quick. Clifford asks, what is Chiesa's value right now? If you've attended, you already answered this earlier.
40 million.
Right? Oscar, it must be a big Fiorentina fan. He said, how much longer can Fiorentina keep players like Chiesa, Milenkovic, and Castrovilli, in your opinion?
Excuse me, what do you...
He's asking, how many more years do you think Fiorentina can keep Chiesa, Milenkovic, Castrovilli? And he added to it, because they're not, if they're not in European football, like, are they able to retain them?
At the moment, I might say Chiesa, 2 weeks.
Okay.
Milenkovic, 2 years.
Okay.
Castrovilli...
5 years.
In the middle?
5 years.
Wow, 5 years? That much? Yes.
Yeah. I love, and by the way, Castrovilli
is from Bari, okay?
Loco,
you got nothing but the best from Bari.
He's the guy.
He is the guy. Number 10 now. Last two, Antonio, they're for you. They've been waiting a little while, so we'll give it to him. Mohammed asked Antonio... it's not for Antonio, it's for Massimo, Dave. But it's about you, that's why. It is. Sorry, you'll understand now. He said, question for Massimo, on a scale of 1 to 10, how badly do you wish you had prime Cassano on Fiorentina right now?
Oh, God.
Really? I love him.
On a scale of 1 to 10, how good was Cassano?
Give him a 10.
Yeah, I remember... The first match he played against Inter. I remember.
His first goal, right?
Yeah. And I remember well that game, because 2 weeks before I received a mail from a Bari supporter, told me, look, we have a very important player that is going to be a crack, Antonio Cassano. And I said, Antonio Cassano, never heard of him. Then... that was the match. I remember I was there in front of TV and said, oh, this is Antonio Cassano, to my colleagues. My colleagues were like, but where is that?
That's awesome.
That's incredible.
Not Fiorentina related, but we do have somebody who asked, what's your top four prediction? Because we had all given our top four prediction, and Nick was asking specifically, can Milan get in that top four?
But do you mean generally?
No, first, second, third, and fourth. Can you do it?
Who's gonna finish?
If you want to say general, you can.
First, second, third,
and four.
Champions League spots.
Who you have to take a guess.
Inter.
Who?
Inter win the Scudetto.
Yeah. Juventus.
Uh huh.
Napoli.
Wow. Okay. I like it.
Atalanta.
Ooh. Wow, no Milan.
I thought Atalanta too.
Massimo, I think I'm changing my mind about you.
And next thing he's going to say, Cassano really wasn't that good.
But you know what? Because I love Milan, okay? But I'm not so convinced in Pioli.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, I don't even like Pioli myself, to be honest.
I don't forget that
what he did for
there was a Milan before Ibrahimovic and a Milan without Ibrahimovic.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Oscar,
with Ibrahimovic and without him,
big difference.
Oscar, who I had said was probably a Fiorentina fan, he said he's an AC Milan fan actually, but Fiorentina is close to my heart. And then he added Forza Antonio and Forza Peter. last thing from Ryan, he said, according to Corriere dello Sport, Totti is close to returning to Roma as either vice president or technical director. Do you have any opinions on this? Do you know anything about it?
I think that they are in talks, and in the future I see a place for Totti. Yeah, it's his destiny. And Friedkin is very sensitive about this issue.
Sensitive meaning he wants to bring Totti back in?
Yeah.
We would love to see it.
Yeah, who
wouldn't? We knew that Totti didn't...
I don't know what kind of job he could do.
Okay, but they want to bring him back.
Yeah, because you know, Roma and Totti,
they go hand in hand.
Would be great, you know. But
his son goes into Trigoria, and you know, he accompanies son all the time to practice.
Well,
and
did you hear what he said about that?
Yeah, he did.
He said during when Palotta was there, he said he wouldn't even step into Trigoria. Yes. He said he would just leave his son and leave. But Totti always said,
no,
if Palotta leaves, he would go back.
Yeah,
he has no problem going back.
Yeah, that's a solution. But I think that Totti has the mind to see the young player.
Mm-hmm.
I think that if Totti says that is a good guy to play soccer,
to invest on,
you can be sure.
There's definitely no doubts about that. Massimo, I'm so happy that we finally got you on. The people really enjoyed this. A lot of Fiorentina, but a lot of great information. So thank you for coming on. And we got to do it a lot more.
Can we edit the part of what he said? Can we edit the part where he didn't put AC Milan in the top four?
No. It's live.
It's live. Oh, sorry.
And guys, Massimo, thank you so much. And we just want to say before we still have the merch drop happening September 25th. So make sure when you go on our website, you can put your email over there. Make sure you signed up and get ready. I think we said it all. Massimo, thank you again. And I think we can all say Forza Fiorentina.
Bravo.
Let's go.
Grande, Massimo.
Awesome, Massimo. You're the man. Oh. Yeah. Wow.